Greetings. Let's continue with part two, answering a set of questions asked by a Muslim brother. Why should someone else suffer for our sins? Why can't God forgive our sins? And in many places, God will forgive sins if you confess. We've addressed and answered the first question in part one. The more I've considered questions two and three, they seem related, so I will address them in tandem. Why can't God forgive our sins? And in many places, God will forgive sins if you confess. Let's take a very brief diversion to critique the first question of the two. Why can't God forgive our sins? There is an unfortunate usage of the word can't. It is unfortunate because it ascribes inability or impotence to God. God himself says there is only one thing that he, God, cannot do, and that is to lie. Numbers 23:19. God is not a man that he should lie, or the son of man that he should change his mind. Does he speak and not act? Does he promise and not fulfill? Hebrews 6:18. That by two immutable things, in which it was impossible for God to lie, we might have a strong consolation, who have fled for refuge to lay hold upon the hope set before us. Titus 1:2, in the hope of eternal life, which God, who cannot lie, promised before time began. Just a quick aside, Muslims claim the Quran has scientific knowledge. This is one clear fact of scientific knowledge in the Bible. Time began. Time had a beginning. This is a very clear reading that the dimension we call time began at some point of history, a point in time that science has now named the Big Bang. Moving on. Why can't God forgive our sins? The only thing that God cannot do is tell a lie. I'm inclined to assume this is simply a cultural, linguistic omission. To me, the context of the questions implies that a single, simple word is missing. Just. Just. Why can't God just forgive our sins? That would assume a deity not only capable, but willing to act randomly, arbitrarily, like Allah. I believe this is the real meaning that fits the context of question two. Why should someone else suffer for, pay for our sins? I would add, why is a sacrifice, any sacrifice, even needed? Why can't God just forgive our sins? That sequence of questions logically builds, don't you agree? I'm not trying to change the questions as a diversion. I'm trying to logically determine the best way to communicate the truth. If you are Muslim and you want me to answer, why can't God forgive our sins? I must answer the following. God can, and does. But he sometimes qualifies his actions. Sometimes he even puts a requirement on us. Sometimes he even uses forgiveness to teach a specific lesson, as we shall see. But realize, we must submit to God's plan. We must submit to his way and not rebel against his requirements. And this is where I began to be forced to merge questions 2 and 3 into the same line of reasoning. Why can't God just forgive our sins? And in many places, God will forgive sins if you confess. God can and does. But you, O human, you, O Muslim, are in no position to dictate to God that he must. Why can't God just forgive our sins? Actually, what I have been calling the third question is really a supporting rationale. It does not ask a question, but rather offers an example that seems in conflict. A question might be, Does God forgive us if we just confess? One possible issue with these questions is simply that they presume to impose on God the way He must forgive. God must forgive sins in a way that seems right in our own eyes. That does place us firmly above God, judging Him and His approach for forgiveness. So let's be good Bereans and study this forgiveness thing in more depth. Buckle up, we're going for a ride. Leviticus 17:11, "For the life of the flesh is in the blood, and I have given it for you on the altar to make atonement for your souls. For it is the blood that makes atonement by the life." This is important to notice. God, by the prophets, has clearly associated blood with life. For the life of the flesh is in the blood, for it is the blood that makes atonement by the life. In the New Testament, the New Covenant, the Holy Spirit has revealed more about this critical link. Hebrews 9:22. According to the law, in fact, nearly everything must be purified with blood, and without the shedding of blood there is no forgiveness. And in this verse, the linkage between blood and forgiveness is established. So the question, why can't God just forgive our sins, ties into the need for forgiveness, which is dependent on blood being shed. This is God's creation and God's rules, brother. Why can't God just forgive our sins? For the life of the flesh is in the blood, for it is the blood that makes atonement by the life. And without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness. At some point, blood must be shed for forgiveness. This is why Jesus, the Messiah, had to die, shed His blood, to obtain forgiveness for the sins of mankind. Fundamentally, you no longer must shed your blood. Jesus has already done so for you, for me, for every man, woman, and child. So there you go, two verses on point, one Old Testament, one New Testament. End of doctrine, right? Not if we wish to respect all scriptures that teach, reveal, or demonstrate instances of forgiveness. Let's begin with something called the Lord's Prayer. Matthew 6:9. "After this manner therefore pray ye, Our Father which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts or sins, as we forgive our debtors, those who sin against us." Hold on there. Forgive our sins as we do something. As we forgive others who have sinned against us. It does not say, forgive our sins because we have shed blood today or sacrificed blood today. So in this case, we pray and ask for forgiveness conditionally. And if you think it through, we are establishing the condition. Please forgive me in the same way that I forgive others. This is from the Lord's Prayer because it is how the Lord Jesus taught us to pray. Think a little more about the meaning of what Jesus taught us to pray and what it means and implies. And God, if I do not forgive, I should not expect your forgiveness. Cut me to the heart, God. Maybe there is more to understand about forgiveness. Maybe, just maybe, forgiveness is less optional than we imagine. I'm not going to veer off into teaching about hypocrisy right now, but it's tempting. Just a note, this is New Testament, but pre-crucifixion, pre-sacrifice. That's important because at different times, different dispensations apply. But let's call this case one, conditional forgiveness. Luke 5:18, "Then behold, men brought on a bed a man who was paralyzed, whom they sought to bring in and lay before him. And when they could not find how they might bring him in because of the crowd, they went up on the housetop and let him down with his bed through the tiling into the midst before Jesus." Pay attention for a moment. This verse identifies two groups, a man who is lame and his friends. Pronouns him and his always apply in this context to the man in the bed, while they can mean only his friends, but may also include him. And when they could not find how they might bring him in because of the crowd, they went up on the housetop and let him down with his bed through the tiling into the midst before Jesus. They were going to get him to Jesus. He was along for the ride. When he, meaning Jesus, saw their faith, he, Jesus, said to him, "Man, your sins are forgiven you." Jesus saw their faith. It does not say his faith alone. And this resulted in Jesus forgiving the man's sins. When he, Jesus, saw their faith, Jesus said to him, "Man, your sins are forgiven you." Now, the whole passage taken in context is a more extensive teaching that Jesus' power as God to forgive and to heal are the same. But regarding forgiveness, pay attention to what triggered Jesus' forgiveness. When he saw their faith, he said to him, "Man, your sins are forgiven you." Faith obtained forgiveness, not a blood sacrifice. Let's call that case two, forgiveness by faith. Just a note, this is still New Testament, but pre-crucifixion, pre-sacrifice. The reason this is critical is because context, context, context. Jesus brought the new covenant foretold by prophet Jeremiah. But this is before his crucifixion and resurrection that established that new covenant. This so far is Jewish people living under the old, first Abrahamic covenant. So I'm calling this case two, forgiveness by faith. And since this is getting long, let's summarize and stop at this point and resume in part three. Why can't God just forgive our sins? We've seen case one, conditional forgiveness. We've seen case two, forgiveness by faith. Even in these cases, with forgiveness without blood sacrifice, the people were doing something. May the Spirit of God open your eyes to the light, your ears to the truth, and your heart to His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.